When we first start learning chemistry, a way to distinguish between a physical and a chemical change often emphasizes the production of new material by pointing out that a process cannot easily be reversed, at least when, say, compared to melting or evaporation. So as students begin to develop a more refined understanding of chemistry and start thinking about reversible reactions, having some visually appealing changes to show is always handy. And today, we're going to be looking at a great example. I've modified this reaction a little from some other variations that are out there to, I hope, optimize it for a classroom setup. As always, you can find links to technician's notes, more information about the reaction, etc., on the Education in Chemistry website. Link will be beneath. Like most other variations out there, we are still using 10 vol, that's 3% hydrogen peroxide. And if you're new to the game, let me reinforce with you that it is really important that you make up 10 vol solutions of peroxide fresh. There's a stabilizer that is added to stock like 100 vol solutions that you'll have, and that stabilizer becomes less effective as you dilute those down. So definitely make it very close to, ideally on the day of the reaction. I've made up around 100 mil of the 10 vol because the maths is easy and that's going to be plenty for many reactions and cycles that we're going to be doing today. If you're a CLEEPS member, you should consult RB045 for diluting down your peroxide. We're going to be using a 1 molar solution of potassium sodium tartrate. You can of course make up a stock solution, but just in case you wanted to make just enough for one demonstration, I'll show you how to do that too. I've got 8.47 grams of the tetrahydrate salt here, and I'm going to dissolve that in 30 ml of water to make up a 1 molar solution. Let's talk glassware. The reaction starts with a small volume of liquid, and you're going to add to this over the demonstration to get it cycling over and over. So that means that that small volume of liquid, to maximize its visibility, you want it to be as tall as possible. So if you do have a 250 ml tall form beaker, I would definitely recommend using that. I don't, I just went for the regular one, and that works totally fine. To simplify some later steps now, I'm popping the tartrate into a 1 liter beaker, and I'll put a white tile underneath to aid visibility of the reaction. I'll measure out 15 ml of the 10 vol hydrogen peroxide and put that into a test tube that's also in the 1 liter beaker. These two solutions will be warmed up before the demonstration, but keep the rest of the peroxide aside at room temperature. Finally, if you pour a few mil of 0.5 molar copper sulfate solution into a beaker so that you can easily suck up 1 mil with a dropping pipette or a small syringe, that will be handy. Using 0.5 molar as opposed to 1 molar copper sulfate means that you don't need to measure volumes less than a milliliter, as you might find if you're working on other variations at this scale. The copper sulfate solution does strongly affect the color and the speed of the demonstration, so working with 1 mil of 0.5 molar felt like a good compromise. Don't forget to wear eye protection. The reaction works best between 60 to 70 degrees Celsius, but the first change is quite exothermic, so aim to start between 50 and 60. My way of doing this is to pop a thermometer into the tartrate solution, add hot water from a kettle to the 1 liter beaker, and then when the tartrate has reached 50, you can then remove the 1 liter beaker, placing the tartrate beaker directly on the white tile, which helpfully has also warmed a little as well. To initiate the reaction, add the 1 mL of your copper sulfate solution and pay attention to the color. We're about to heavily dilute the solution, but it's still a vibrant blue. We must have made a different, more darkly colored complex. Bubbles of gas are being released now, and then depending on the temperature you began with, after about 10 to 15 seconds, the blue color fades and a golden copper 1 complex is produced, while at the same time the temperature jumps right up to around 70 degrees Celsius. Initially, the copper acts as a catalyst for the decomposition of the hydrogen peroxide. As the peroxide concentration drops relative to the concentration of the tartrate, the copper itself becomes a reactant and is reduced to the copper 1 complex. But with the concentrations and volumes chosen, only a small amount of the tartrate is consumed on each round. That means that further additions of peroxide can reoxidize the copper back up to copper 2 and start the process all over again. Temperature management is crucial for a good effect. That's why I kept the rest of the peroxide at room temperature. If it was heated, then the next exotherm, when it comes along, would potentially heat the solution above 70 degrees Celsius, at which point the cycling of the reaction does somewhat become inhibited. We want to keep it, if possible, somewhere between 60 and 70 degrees Celsius by riding those exotherms as we go along. Adding in 10 mil of the peroxide will allow us to sort of drop the temperature down from near 70 back into that sort of sweet zone and give us a little bit of buffer from above. You can repeat this process over and over again with 10 mil additions of peroxide until, if you haven't got bored before then, eventually the tartrate concentration just drops too low. Variations on this demonstration call for larger volumes of peroxide. I've reduced the relative amount of peroxide to reduce the latency period. And that means that, you know, if you get distracted by a class, you're less likely to see your temperature drop too far below that sweet spot and find that the exotherm never comes along to rescue you and bring that temperature back up and keep things going at a reasonable pace. If you work with fresh peroxide, if you get that initial solution when you're adding your tartrate in with your peroxide between that sort of sweet spot, 50 to 60 Celsius, this is pretty bomb-proof and very worthwhile doing with a class. You can easily show how a chemical reaction with color changes, precipitation, gas evolution can be made seemingly to reverse. And if you're using this to lead into equilibria, you might then think about asking your students whether or not this really represents a reaction that has reversed, or is there something else going on? Preparing them to start thinking about the importance of a genuinely closed system. See you next time.